thanks for joining me today. I really appreciate it. Thanks, Amy, and Rich Gunther, and the UXPA board, who's allowed me to be here today to talk to you about UX strategy. It's a topic that I'm very excited about. It's a big growth area, and very passionate about the subject, as you'll probably see. And I wish they could put me on this side. I could see everybody, but it is on this side. I put together some topics. I don't really like PowerPoint karaoke, so I'm just going to stand up here and sing along to the slides I created. So I hope that we're able to have an insightful interaction during this hour, or at least plant seeds for further conversation. I do have a stack of business cards in the front of the back. So if I do leave some questions unanswered, then by all means, get in touch with me. I have seven basic elements, as well as an introduction. I'm planning on about 5 minutes each, so that should leave us about 20 minutes for interaction and dialogue. So I'm hoping that we'll be able to have a meaningful conversation around so many topics here. So what qualifies me to talk about UX strategy at UXPA? Well, my day job is consulting. I put together UX strategy foundations for companies. Started in Italian life science in 1996 in Barcelona. Very nice atmosphere to begin that. In 2002, I started my own company. I'm not sure I did that. In 2009, I started having a real project that involved UX strategy, the things that we're going to talk about today. In fact, my current project is UX strategy, long-term strategy for a bank in Europe. So I've spent the last few months in Europe working. I just came back a couple of days ago for this session, so I'm still a little bit jet lagged. As you can see, I have some brain lapses, but when I'm reading my slides, it's amazing. So I'm going to try to avoid that. But anyway, I feel like there's a long-term growth pattern for UX strategy. That's what I try to gear all my meetings towards. I started a LinkedIn group called UX Strategy and Planning. It's about UX strategy, of course. Out of that, as Amy said, there's a conference that's coming on in September. It's called UX Strat. It's all about basically what we're talking about today. I don't know if you're in my workshop a little bit later today as well. But this is a conference where about 30 speakers or so are going to be talking solely about UX strategy. So as you can see, I'm kind of invested in this topic. And I think it's something that's going to be much bigger in the future. It's not really quite here yet. You see some job announcements for UX strategy there to you. I know a few UX strategists, but really I'd say it's just beginning of the topic. We do have a book that's probably coming out through Morgan Kaufman, and my co-author Stephanie Sancusino. That is a book on experience strategy. It's due out in 2014. And then I do a radio column on UX owners, and also write for UX magazine about UX strategy. I also teach graduate students in business about user experience. And then do workshops, corporate workshops on UX strategy as well. So those are all the different little pieces that you can see in the last 4 years. And that's really what I have to gear my professional practice to is UX strategy. So I'm looking for some definitions. People are confused about what strategy means. You read things all the time that it's almost like there's no such thing as strategy. But we do need a few terms to get on the same page about what strategy is. First, let's start with a goal. In my mind, a goal is some desired future state. That's what a goal is. So if you have business goals, etc., that's some state that the business wants to reach sometime in the future. A strategy is the approach or the big idea or the concept that's going to help you reach that goal. And then a tactic is an action that you take to reach the goal that's in line with the strategy. And it's really that simple. Sports teams have strategies. My son plays high school football. He's a great offensive tackle. And I thought that was just like smashing people. He's very big and muscular. But actually, it's all about strategy. He learns strategy every single day. He's at school from 6 in the morning to 6 at night. They watch films. And he knows just where people are moving by the way that they're standing. And so strategy is something that sports teams do. Countries have strategies. I mentioned here for 2 months just now. My in-laws live in Germany. So I visited them, and I can tell you that Germany has very tight focus on fiscal responsibility, down to personal level. It was a ouch for me. But anyway, they permeate every area they daily life. That's their strategy. You can see the outcomes of that. Germany grows, their growth rate continues. Investors have strategies. For example, one of the strategies is to find undervalued companies that have very strong fundamentals. That's a strategy. Entertainers have strategies. I don't recognize these people. Anybody recognize them? Okay. One Direction. Some of your children have coaches on the wall. But Simon Cowell's strategy was to use this stage to bring forward lots of talented people and then pick out a few gems that you can bring a lot of credit. Even nonprofits have strategies. World Vision, their strategy is to address the causes of poverty and not just to facilitate the poverty. So strategy is all around us. It's a way of reaching goals. That's the point. But UX, user experience, how does that have a strategy? This is going to summarize basically what the talk is about today. So in my mind, and again, I've only been doing this 4 years, but this is what I think the UX strategy is. First of all, our communication, overall approach. I'm thinking of a developer, a work product of UX strategy. It's communicating an overarching concept, an overarching big idea, the kind of North Star that all activities in that UX group or that design group have to line up with, or even off course. Okay, that's what a UX strategy should do. It should provide that North Star that aligns every activity in the UX group. It should also align with business strategy. I'm going to pick up about this. It should differentiate a digital channel from one company, your company, against its competitors, so that people can tell the difference. It should address prioritized customer segments, and should talk about how to address their needs and wants, et cetera. And then finally, it should offer a roadmap. A roadmap connects you from the current state to this desired future state or your goals. And so these are the things that we're going to talk about in this session. What's tactical is basically, what's not strategy, and that is, let's do what seems right today. And then tomorrow, do what seems right tomorrow. The next week, there's a new pattern, there's a new device, there's a new something else. Let's do what's best with that device. That's a tactical, tactical UX. What a lot of people say to me in the last 4 years is, isn't UX in general strategic? Why are you bringing this thing up called UX strategy? All UX is strategic, and we're all strategic. Okay, that's where it breaks down. UX strategy is not about being strategic. All design is strategic to some extent. UX strategy is a role. It's a set of deliverables. It's a set of practices. It's time spent doing certain things and not doing other things. It's a practice that's starting to emerge. It has a lot of growth. And so, basically, I would say, all UX, it may be strategic, but it's not all UX strategy. People working in UX are not all doing UX strategy. And so I'm going to try to convince you of one thing today. It's a thing. It's a real thing. And it's going to be growing. I think it's an important thing. You need it. But not everybody needs the same degree of UX strategy. There are arguments about this in our UX strategy and planning group, but I don't believe that everybody needs a bunch of UX strategy. It depends on the value that is being placed on UX pieces that you're generating and what impact you can have with UX strategy. I don't want to waste a bunch of time, but it's going to have no impact. But when the impact is large, when optimizing what you're doing is going to bring a big reward, there is worth to invest more time and energy in user experience strategy. Now I'm going to start with the seven things. Basically, the first thing is vision. Vision is seeing this desired future state in enough detail that you're able to get it. or does someone else be able to get that? Does anybody recognize it? What this is? Nobody. Okay. This is a dino book.
Uh-huh.
And in 1972, Alan Kay came up with this dino book concept, and he said it should. If you read this. Be a book-sized computer, have high-contrast plasma screen, have a keyboard with no moving parts, connections to a global network, ability to purchase and transfer files, and a target price of $500. That was 1972. A lot of techies, you know, some 41 years later. And you have to remember, 1972, most people hadn't even ever seen a personal computer. They weren't a personal computer. Most people hadn't even seen any kind of computer. That's a vision. That's incredible. But the problem with this idea is that geniuses have vision, and the rest of us just fudge along day to day. That's wrong. A vision is something that takes effort, takes a focused effort, like the bank we're working for right now. My task is to imagine banking in 2020, in 2019, in 2018, 17, 16, 15, 14. Actually, that should be all short term. So my job is to envision what are people doing 7 years from now in banking, with physical devices or whatever, in their wearable computers or whatever thing that they're doing it with. And so the objective for me is to imagine that future state and what's it like when all the problems that people have today are solved. And so it's important to develop a coherent vision of the future to understand what should happen next with user experience in your realm as well. Vision translates into goals. Goals translate into tactics. And your goals require strategy if you want to. And so the homework for this session is to imagine your objectives, where you're at in your company, and in your environment, why you came to this conference. There must be some user experience stuff that is future-looking to you. To get in quiet place and imagine what all the barriers you've got. Where are the restrictions on the experience that you're in? Where are the problems? What do people have? How can I imagine a future state where these problems are all solved? And what does it look like? And then how do I bring my environment to that place where all these problems are solved? And I do have a moment now for a question about vision. We have one question. Anybody have one about vision? Yes? What is the right time and place and audience to communicate a UX vision? Vision isn't necessarily the first step in the UX strategy project, like the project I'm working on today. Our first step was not to imagine a vision. First, we had to get some understanding. We had to go back through and read a lot of data. We had to go through lots of reports, current experiences, competitive experiences, before we even had an understanding of the context and the lifestyle and all the things that were leading up to the vision. And then I took a long hot bath and just, you know. And then we had sessions where we together were doing vision exercises. But the time to communicate the vision, I believe, is after it's fully formed into something that you can communicate that is coherent. I think that people are not ready to hear a message about a vision that is really half-baked. And so I believe that there's a point where you feel like this is it. And I want to communicate that. And then, like now, we're not stopping communicating. We have a vision for what these, the differentiation for the bank is going to be in terms of the 2X strategy. And so we have it on the walls. Executives walk by all the time and they see the vision as it's explained in the conceptual documents that we produce. And it's really every meeting that we're in where we're talking about anything having to do with user experience, we're reinforcing the vision. Can I answer the question? Alright, let's move on to business strategy alignment. This is certainly the most unfun part of business strategy. For some people, I actually enjoy it. business, duties, and technology. This is a diagram I've seen for the past 15 years and all kinds of materials. Really, it's just not going to do anymore. This is not the age of paying attention to business when you're doing design. That's not sufficient. There's a lot more to this equation than just a Venn diagram. It has to do with goals, first of all. My question is, does UX have goals? I kind of think, you know, we have some goals like boost conversion by 0.5%. That's a goal. But that's a sub-goal. The entity or the organization or the business then kind of has goals. And as a UX guy, consultant, strategist, my goals are to reach their goals. So in a sense, I don't really have my own goal. Now, there are objectives that I have along the way to meet their goals, but I think everyone on the UX team needs to understand what are the goals of the business. And I have some questions around that to share with you. It takes a while to do what I'm about to say. The first thing I think you need to do is to establish a relationship with the business strategy. In a startup, that might be the CEO. It might be everything. Establish a relationship with business strategy. That's not all you need. Depending on your company, depending on your environment, there might be a credibility gap where they feel like you aren't going to understand what we do. You don't have a background to understand what we do. So establishing that relationship is key. And one step of doing that is to obtain their documentation. They produce a lot of documentation that guides the daily machine that is that business. Some examples, annual operating plan. Now this thing may feel like you don't have any business looking at this. And so it might take some work to convince them that what's in that annual operating plan should be reflected in the visual channel and in the customer experience. That's one type of document. Market data. Where are we in terms of market share? Where is our online market share compared to our offline market share? Sometimes there's a gap. Why is there a gap? Competitive data. A lot of that's available. Marketing strategy, prioritization, product development, customer segments, you know, it goes on and on. And then the goal is to connect the business strategy with the user experience. And that can be problematic. Because the first thing they send you is something like this. Okay, so let's do it. What about business strategy? What is our strategy? So this is like the first document we get from the business strategist. Let's see what you do with that. Well, there's not a lot that I can do with this, except for kind of the red, blue, and yellow color scheme. I can take it from this graph, but I can't really do much in terms of user experience with this graph. And then they send me something like this that has, well, it's got some categories. These are some topics that they use. These are products that we have. So I'm starting to see kind of an information architecture fall out of some of the business strategy. These are some prioritized, high-level product taxonomies that are important. It's got a few things like high output, high efficiency. So that's a characteristic of the products that are leading products that we sell. A broad lineup, choose lightness. Okay, these are some, it's starting to be a little bit more significant to me about how I'm using and driving the user experience and driving customers to engage with digital channels. Maybe I can start using some of that. But really, this process with the first project I was doing for, the project lasted 7 months. We sat down and started looking through all the documentation for business strategies. And we started finding some different things. This is still the same company, coming through that one with business strategies. Starting to see things like global environments, eco-friendly. I see some very high-level business units represented here. And the business strategy documentation is like this. You're digging, and you're finding things, but suddenly I get to a point where if the user experience isn't reflecting what you see on the slide, I'm not going to align with business. If I can't see, take apart the pieces that you're designing and you're creating and see the business strategy reflected in what you're doing, then I would say there's not alignment and there's some work to be done in terms of bringing that into alignment. So, I have a few questions for you. These are questions I ask clients all the time. I ask UX teams. These are kind of more like an approach, I guess, for as soon as you ask people. So ask them these kinds of questions. If you haven't answered any questions, just raise your hand or call them. So what moves the needle in terms of profitability? You're thinking about the needle, like how profitable this company is when X happens, we're more profitable. And the obvious one is we sell more, is one. But what are the things that make, you know, in retail, for example, the weather? The weather changes your profitability. So, in your business, what moves the needle in terms of its profitability? Yes? Okay, funding from the government. When that happens, okay, so a priority for UX strategy in this company would be around this particular topic and getting that topic so that it's way high up in the experience. It's not very 20 clicks or 20 tasks or scrolls deep where now I'm finally getting to this section and I can read about that. It's at the top. It's at the top of your list. It needs to be at the top of the experience. How can UX, do you have a needle in your company that moves? It has profitability built into it. How does UX change the needle? Where does what you do impact that needle? Okay, so cutting operational costs. So user experience is able to do that. Okay. Digital channels, yes. Okay, so reducing support calls is a way to build through user experience a case for the value that you're adding to it. That's fine. Okay, customer retention and attraction. So retention, like for a bank, there are a few things that make customers stay with banks. It's a little bit of capital, but there are a few things. If those things aren't evident in your experience, then it's not aligned with the business. Third question, how does the business vision and operating plan directly impact UX design? This would imply that you know what the business vision and operating plan are to be able to value this. How does the business vision and operating plan directly impact UX design? And can I take a look at the digital channels that we're creating and see it? Okay, so we're getting a little deeper, getting a little bit deeper waters. If I'm trying to present to C-level executives in a Fortune 500 company, and I don't know how they make money, and I don't know what changes in profitability, and I don't know what the presentation this morning on an operating plan for 2014 is, are they going to take it seriously? As I'm going to lead this company into the digital age, if I don't even know what makes them money, I don't even know what their plans are, their secret plans for next year, how we're going to create this much more market share, and this product will take the lead, and we're going to take this brand position. And the answer is it's challenging to get that level of visibility and funding if I'm not able to figure out what those are. So one of the first things I'm doing in coaching senior UX leaders is to say you have to establish a relationship that can get you to the document. And then operating plan hits, you have a copy of the next quarter. Soon after that. So you know where those other people are driving the company, but I don't think that the teams have got everybody to do this. But again, how are they doing the right activities each day if they don't know the North Star where they're supposed to be going? What's the return on investment of UX success? So let's say that, I don't know if projects are working right now, but let's say that your current project and what you're trying to achieve in each was awesome, and people loved it. Would it change the revenue 10% of the company? So I do a lot of retail work, user experience strategy, and I need to try to figure out if we need to have a better configurator, or if I can get the perfect 3D floating modeling digitally on somebody, it's going to cost a bazillion dollars to produce that, what's the outcome? What's the result? So how can I bring our strategy to very serious company to be dealing with the service? Okay. So I kind of need to know when I crank up UX and make it better, what happens to the rest of the machine? 10 years ago, the retailer would say, not much, it's smaller than our smallest store. And the revenues are that small, but they're always changing, especially with mobile, in-store mobile, and things like that. They're understanding that digital channels are driving revenue on a large scale. Anybody have an answer for this one? What kinds of customer decision factors influence usage and profit? Are they category specific? When people, like, if you're buying things, you don't buy them the same. Even if you have maybe a style that is super cheap. And I have that style in everything that I do. But that's not how I buy stuff. If I'm buying a house, I don't buy a house the same way I buy for shoes. I have different factors that are influencing. So what kind of customer decision factors influence profits from user experiences that you're working on? Do you know the levers? Because you know the levers of customers, I'm not talking about controlling people or manipulating customers into buying stuff. I don't have any desire to do that. But what are the factors that make them make decisions? Maybe you're dealing with internal company portals. What are the factors that lead to people having satisfaction with what you've created? And what are the factors that lead to your success? Okay, then they purchase something. So that's a factor that if that happens, then you change the result. Now, when people shop with things online, there's usually a certain life context to why they're shopping online. If your refrigerator broke or your toilet broke, you're not shopping online. You know, if you do that, you need to solve it right now. You can't wait for it to arrive. So that tells me immediately that my mental context is I'm doing shopping for different kinds of things. And so I've worked with a lot of companies that do female apparel. More than any man should know. Because I've been in homes, I've had people do diaries and so on. And so there are decision factors that vary based on whatever context we develop in the user experience. So, I'm not going to keep going through these, just doing the presentation. But basically, there are questions that I try to lead the readers through. Understand where can we cause the biggest difference in the next 3 years for user experience data. I want to move on to something else. Business travel alignment is, that's a tough one, but it's worth that. Customer data. Customer data is increasing rapidly. I don't know if you've seen any statistics, but there's so many devices and capture points there that the digital volume of data is growing at an amazing rate. My friends from User Zero and Ovo Studios out in the hall there, they are in the business of helping people sort through customer data and collect customer data. But customer data is increasing rapidly. Data is getting cheaper and easier to collect. For some people, data means talking to 5 users about what they do or don't experience. For other companies, like the company that won the Country of Lexington Research, for my team, for them it was a statistical model that's piloted and tested in multiple global markets. And that's their minimum standard. The Gap contacted me about doing some research in China with iPads at point of sale. And I would love to do that, but I just don't have the scale or the scope or the knowledge or the people or anything to be able to do something like that. It's so big, but that's the level that they're operating at. And so we mean different things when we say data. If somebody says, they put data, it means many, many different things. So I'm going to explain my philosophy of research. Best messy design projects like this diamond. They start off here. This is a discovery period. You go broad first, like at the bank, you start doing a whole bunch of mock-ups and concepts and things like that. So I'm very broad, lots of different ideas. But there comes a point where things are on paper that other people can see, like the question about their vision. There's something out there. Okay, that's when it doesn't go broad anymore. gets down, as people look at it, they're talking about it, it starts to narrow and focus. And then it gets more to the evaluative side of things. So what that means is that there's a part where the design solution is unknown, and then the design solution is known. And there are methods that go along with those different points in time. So ethnographic research, which I do a lot of, happens more in the discovery phase. The product is almost ready, and we're doing that for ethnographic study, and people, it's not going to change much. A survey might be useful there, some definite views. But once it's a thing, then it's more towards formative type research. So formative usability studies. And then finally, once it's already kind of like play, and then a little hungry, then it's more like evaluative usability. So the research method has to be suitable for the stage you're at in terms of design. But I think what's more important is that when you have research data, it doesn't sort of end there, and then you have some general notions about what you might want to do with that data. It really depends on connecting the wires between your data and the data. If we've done a study, like we did an in-home study for letters, and we were in people's homes across the country, if our highlights video that we showed to executives, here's where your customers are at in terms of digital channels, here's what they want to use, here's the way to create it, here's the roadmap. If I look at their digital properties, I can't see the research data reflected in what I'm looking at, then that research is useless. So it's that connecting to the wires that led me to start my own company in 2002. I want to see the top line results at least on every research project somewhere in the design and see it and be able to point to it. There are some methods that are better for this and some methods that are not as good. I think some of the more discovery-oriented methods are better for guiding companies in the discovery phase in the UX strategy. And some methods I find less useful for UX strategy are more on the evaluative side. And so yeah, it's just back to the kind of things on the front side of the diamond. I think it works for our strategy, because strategy is not something you can make up in the middle as you're about to launch. Strategy is kind of the North Star guiding everything. It kind of has to be at the beginning. I realize agile is having a big effect on this. And how far in front of agile can you get? Like Josh Stein was going to talk about US Strat in September. And like about the same topic, how do you mesh these two things together? And then just some example deliverables. I'm not going to belabor these points. These are things you're already all familiar with. But there are different stages of that discovery period. And these are the kind of things that we produce based on the project, the US strategy project, the US research project. These are the standard deliverables for that. I do prefer for US strategy projects to be in vivo, so in the actual setting, where the strategy is going to be taking place, which now, you know, a lot of times, is mobile, right? And so I find that it's, our methods are changing a lot. We've done a lot of lab studies in the beginning, we've moved to portable labs, then we started in homes, and stores, and airports. But what we're doing now is a little different. Just going to make this work better. Oops.
So right now I'm currently trying to find a place to eat for dinner, and I have an app on my phone called Urban Spoon. It's this really cool app that tells you what kind of places you should go to, narrows down your food choices by price and what you're in the mood for. So right now I think I'm going to look into...
Okay, blah, blah, blah. These are video diaries, and it's possible to go into 100 hours of videos. It's really, it's going to destroy my results. That's why a graduate student is really, you have to analyze the data as it's coming out. But video diaries give us a very interesting window into this changing behavior, particularly your younger demographics. But we've had even older people in older demographics give us like a 4-hour video diary explaining everything that they do and showing themselves doing it offline, online, in stores, wherever they are. I think this is a thing too. I think this is a real thing. It hasn't quite caught on. I even in contact with some of these videos, etc. I think that it's a way to get a window. People aren't self-conscious. It's really surprising. You think that, oh, I'm going to take what I want you to know about me. I think that's more actually when we're doing the inner research and when we're in the lab. I think it's more that reflective behavior where they're reflecting things they expect, you need to expect from them. And the video diary is surprising. People forget what's going on. I don't know, it's just like this prediction here. They're just showing themselves going through the motions. And they do like a 2-hour video diary usually. And so they're showing how their habits are changing, especially with mobile. It's one of the aspects that we use for a lot. And I think that's something that people seem to be underestimating is what is really in front of us with big data. And I know that's a term that people throw around a lot and probably mean a lot. It's a lot of but I think it's gonna change user experience. When there are petabytes of data on what customers do, and there's statistical analysis, this is something that I'm explaining to the bank, that we're able to give people a kind of profile that we know a million people like that person has succeeded with in the past. That kind of data is very powerful. It's just now beginning. We don't have the tools to use all the data yet. They're just the older tools of data manipulation aren't suitable for this kind of modeling. Now again, I'm not saying that because I want to control everyone and make them, I have this model to know what to do, but it's a model that tells me here's what's successful, here's what makes people successful, here's what makes them happy. Here's what, here's the way that people behave when they're doing what they want to do. And so big data is going to provide these kind of models where a team brainstorming what should be happening with this user experience versus a model that shows this is going to give you a 90% chance of 20% market penetration, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. Whether I want it to happen or whether I'm making it happen, it's still not a point at all. Big data is there, and it's going to impact us a lot. So I just showed some stuff on research and customer data. Any questions? Yes? Have a section on that.
Yes. What's the old model that you made actually in terms of the market that I lost?
Can you say that again,
please? The old AD testing, the model testing, and how that is related to the ROI, is it something that you can do the new tool in the same document?
Well, so the question is, what's the role of AD testing? Things like the research diamond and some of these pieces that I'm talking about here. There are possibilities that we can put in front of people many thousands of times, right? So there's some marketing-driven campaigns that are like, let's just keep changing the message, keep changing the message. I think what UX strategy, which I'm supposed to be representing it, would say that is that it's like trial and error. That there are some things, some limited number of things I can change, that when I change them, some will be more successful than others. Let's move in the area of that success. In terms of incremental improvement, I think that's a really good model. It's using our statistics, it's getting us the data we need. I think the ROI is really high. It's getting us better results. But the problem with incremental improvement is it doesn't make leaps. And it doesn't make quantum leaps of what the experience should be. So I think UX strategy needs to say, let's pull apart the psychology and the situation that people are trying to deal with. They've been doing it analog all the time. We want to make it digital, let's understand the behavior, let's create a solution that is maybe very different from something that you can imagine or just change a little bit now to move forward. That's my name. Okay, competitive landscape. Competitive landscape is something all of us are aware of. And I don't know if too many people are in a situation where their competitors are irrelevant. I have heard people have told me that we're innovators, so we don't care where our competitors are. But that just doesn't make sense anymore. There are people coming out from nowhere with payment solutions, et cetera, where the competitive landscape is very, very important to what we're doing. Our particular area, financial services, retail, things like that, very clear competition. So we monitor the competition. We do competitive audits. We look at the websites, mobile apps. We're trying to help our clients understand what's everybody doing, where they're at, what's coming out now, what's coming out next. So we do audits where we try to find out what pieces are in place for students on the only sites that want to have updated and get Spanish, same product. And we use Spanish, but it's very true to do that. We look at 100 products. So we look carefully at competitors and we do monitoring on a regular basis. And we try to figure out where the competition is so we can beat them, because that's what I think strategy is to win. So we create spreadsheets like this where we're looking at feature sets. Some simple ones like this, we just give away some more complicated cases of competitive landscape, and we do that more as an engagement. So I'd ask you, how do you keep track of your competitors? What's your approach? Market research? Okay, market research. So how do you go about doing that? Okay, surveys, third-party surveys, and we want to keep track of competition, satisfaction, and things like that. Yes? Okay, ask customers to demonstrate it to you. Problem is here. All the competitive software in the lab, that's it. User testing? Okay, so user testing, using a product like UserZoom or something like this lets you compare different products together. Yes? Okay, so sounds fun, competitive intelligence in the field. Awesome. What else? How do you keep track of competitors? Yes. Okay, so you benchmark against them, and what's the approach for getting that? Okay, so do task analysis and some kind of time on task measures. Compares. But experience modeling. This is one of the shortest sections I have in the presentation. It's hard to explain what experience modeling is. I try it with my graduate students at UGA, University of Georgia Business School, but I don't know, it's hard to explain. But somehow, there's a need to understand behavior in a way that's more operational for the people who are participating in it. And so creating an experience model is basically saying there's an analog behavior, there's an analog well. How do I get that digital? What's the best digital experience I can create that is going to take place of what people are doing in offline? Obviously, financial services is very, very important. They're where retail wants to continue to follow that mission there. Understanding the behaviors in depth is we're parsing from the model with API. So I'm going to give you the approach that we use and basically become very familiar with what we need to do with the research that you guys is something like that. To understand the real world phenomena, we create a comprehensive list of entities. So what are the pieces that are involved in this experience? We sketch the processes out, just like flows. We group things that are similar together. And then we consolidate it and simplify it into some kind of a picture that shows you how people are behaving together. And then we create another behavioral model that is how we would like the digital activities to occur, how we expect the behavior to be successful. So that's experience modeling. It's a very complicated topic there, and it doesn't do justice, but we're not in terms of being able to explain. I can't actually show the real experience model, that's the problem. Because these belong to companies and they are a company that can look at the strategy of how they're going to do things digitally. So I can't really show them that. That's all that's right. Behavioral segmentation, personas, and we were a little bit persona to death. So I'm not really going to talk too much about this. I think we had a lot of opportunities to learn about personas, but I still think it's a very important part of the strategy to understand how different people behave and how they can use a sustainable solution I've created differently than other people in my customer base. So, this is an approach that we're looking at, and we're going to understand the feelings of it, and then back. And this is our approach for creating personas. So first, we look at all the data. For large companies, that's going to be a lot of data. There are customers that we have that have 1 million interviews. That means they've done so many interviews that the data is no longer qualitative, it's quantitative data. And we require some special analysis tools. But our approach is first see what data do you already have. And then we conduct whatever research is necessary to bring it up to the current data, which of course, because the data is changing so rapidly, really the persona is being updated on a frequent basis to be relevant to how people are using digital channels. Then we really try to do an in-depth analysis and see what the customer's needs are against what their current solutions are. And then that's one of my questions earlier, what are the factors that influence the behaviors? What makes you say yes to that new car? What makes you be able to buy a new car online? That's kind of challenging. But what about it is going to make you use a personal finance manager? So you're paying for all your bills and expenses. How many of you use personal finance managers today? I think about 15. So what makes people do that versus people that are not getting all the information? Those are factors that impact the behaviors. And then we create real profiles for real people, but then they have these variables and these factors in the profile, and we try to see how they differ from one another. And then we try to operationalize the variables. That's an anthropological word, which just means, okay, you say convenience is very important to customers who are shopping online. Okay. So then operationalizing the variables means what does convenience mean to you in this context? So if it's buying paint, then maybe it means I can walk up to the counter and look at a photograph of the paint on the wall. They can statistically analyze that and understand how much it's faded. And so if I painted that wall and then give me a color that almost exactly matches that, that's convenient to me in that context. If I'm buying a pair of shoes, that's not what convenience to me. I've got a package that came with it. No postage on my part. I put the shoes inside, put it back in the mailbox, and they're gone when my credit is restored to me for that pair of shoes. That's what made that was great. It was unbelievable. And that's operationalizing the variables, understanding really what does it mean when you have these high-level concepts that are built into our user experience classification. And then we create personas that represent these segments. We prioritize on whatever value that we're able to get out of a quantitative study. So they might go to 1,000 customers and say, if you have this feature set, which buy more, which features are more important to you? So we try to get some quantitative data behind the characteristics of the personas. We develop a strategy for engaging personas, and then we try to measure the real impact of that. Okay, we have how much does Diane work? Here's her persona, here's all the stuff about her, here's what she does. Okay, we put her in place, we created a design, hopefully Diane has needs to take into account the number. It costs X to bring to the right block, and we're going to do that. What did it mean? What would it look like? So I think if we don't have that quantitative step, it's hard to set the strategy. I think the hard part of personas is just understanding what what variables to use. Sorry about that. What variables should we use to differentiate the personas? And that basis of differentiation, those variables, really decide the quality of that output. If you're using the wrong variables for differentiating people, then differentiating is useless. And so sometimes, we create scales, like semantic potential scales will have these variables on one end or the other. And then the personas should fall in very different areas. If you have the key variables, like you know kind of what determines your experience in a certain area of your life, For some of them, shouldn't be similar in any of those variables. They should be very, very different variables. Okay, let me come to the roadmap. The roadmap is, you know, what do we do? And then more importantly, I think, what do we don't do? What's up front of the workshop where we have these thousand things that we need to do? What do we not do? And also, what do we do in what order? And Mark Langelo said, someone asked him, how much do this great David statue? And he said, mark the block of marble and chip away everything that wasn't David. That's pretty smart. And so that's what we need to do in our roadmap. So we can deprioritize things that are bad ideas and not important. And prioritize the rest. And so here's our process for how we do that. There are a lot of processes for this, how to prioritize feature sets, but your strategy requires that you understand that you're doing the highest priority item to win the highest gain. So whatever your approach is for prioritization, we have kind of a model right now where we're taking input from banks, we're taking input from customers, taking input from competition, and we're creating a matrix and we're pointing to different feature sets. And then what falls out of that is a roadmap of what we should do next, what we should do after that, what we should do after that. But there are million model products, another way to do it is just transform through customer interaction, etc. And there are a few other things that impact your strategy. Society is changing, technology is changing, social, mobile, global. Those things are going to impact your strategy because they're just big forces that are outside of you. The way that you develop, what your products are, maybe even the responsive nature of what you're developing, well, that's very tactical. On the other hand, for the bank, for example, should the mobile experience be different than the desktop experience? Or should it be just responsive and scroll 35 screens?